Great job, choir. I may be biased, though. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Pacific Unitarian Church. My name is Gary Hart, and I will be your worship associate today as we seek to represent progressive religious thought and anti-racism practices in the South Bay. If you are new here today, we want you to know we have childcare for preschoolers and religious education for school-age kids. RE begins directly after the children's moment. We welcome people of all creeds, races, sexual orientation, and gender identities. We remember that this church sits on what was Tongva land, and we acknowledge that these indigenous people are still among us and thank them for this place as we seek to bring peace into the world. And now your favorite part, announcements. The Minister Search Committee is in final negotiations with their candidate. All will be revealed next Sunday. And trust me, you can't get anything out of that search committee. Postcards for Get Out the Vote will be available next week, not this week. So next week we get your postcards for the Get Out the Vote writing campaign. And this afternoon at 3 o'clock, wonderful chamber music, and it's free. So stop by and see the chamber music today. Pledge news. Just a reminder that we'll be holding our pledge drive until April 14th, and our goal this year is $300,000. This number is larger than ever, and in order to reach it, we are requesting you please consider increasing your pledge 10% over the last year. And for those who have never pledged, it's your time to do it now. The bottom line is that we need everyone to pledge in order to make that goal, no matter how large or small. Let's all work together on building a new way for our beloved PUC. And we stand today at 36%. We're 36% of our goal, or 107,516. And that's updated for the number they have up there. We actually got more pledges this morning. We'll take them every time we can get them. All right, now it's time for chalice lighting. As we light our chalice today, let us remember that we are part of a great community of faith. Let us know that thousands of Unitarian Universalists all around the globe are lighting their chalices today and hoping for peace and justice for all, just as we are. May this dancing flame inspire us to fill our lives with the Unitarian Universalist ideals of love, justice, and truth.
And we have one more announcement today, so we'll start with that. Kiki, do you want to come on up?
Today, after the service, we have an RE, religious education, religious exploration. Andrea and Melissa and Reverend Chloe and I have put together a wonderful little workshop on the book On Repentance and Repair, Making Amends in an Unapologetic World by Danya Ruttenberg. And what you need to know is you don't have to read the book. I will admit, I haven't even finished it. Nothing will be falling short if you show up, if this is the first time you've even heard that this was happening. So please grab your lunch and join us in the library if you are interested. And here's a little quote. If we want to build a world that determines appropriate consequences for harm, that centers the needs and healing of those most impacted, and that helps the perpetrator transform into an agent of healing, repair, and ongoing renewal, we have tremendous cultural and systemic work to do. So please join us to start that work here. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. It's lovely. Good morning. It's lovely to be with you all on this cold but fairly clear morning. I can't believe that it was in the 40s last night. Our opening reading this morning is The Journey by Mary Oliver. One day you finally knew what you had to do and began, though the voices around you kept shouting their bad advice, though the whole house began to tremble and you felt the old tug at your ankles. Mend my life, each voice cried, but you didn't stop. You knew that you had to do, though the wind pried with its stiff fingers at the very foundations, though their melancholy was terrible. It was already late enough in a wild night, and the road full of fallen branches and stones. But little by little, as you left their voices behind, the stars began to burn through the sheets of clouds, and there was a new voice, which you slowly recognized as your own, that kept you company as you strode deeper and deeper into the world, determined to do the only thing you could do, determined to save the only life you could save. I loved the fact that this reading mentions stars today because I'm thinking about everyone who's going out to see the eclipse this week, everyone who's traveling, who's camping. And I send all of those folks blessings as they observe our world in another way. Our opening hymn this morning is number 22, Dear Weaver of Our Lives' Design. And you're welcome to stand as you're willing and able. And if you all would join me in reading our covenant, it can be found in your order of service, or it'll be up on the screen. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth and love, and to help one another.
Hello. I'd like to welcome the children to come up if they would like right now. I'm Cara, coordinator of religious education, and I would like to welcome Johnny up today. He's going to help with the time for all ages. We have a story and a song from Winnie the Pooh about friendship. Does that sound good? Yeah. Oh, thank you. Okay. Okay. Now I'm going to read the story about Pooh. It occurred to Pooh and Piglet that they hadn't heard from Eeyore for several days, so they put on their hats and coats and trotted across the 100-acre wood to Eeyore's stick house. "Hello, Eeyore," said Pooh. "Hello, Pooh. Hello, Piglet," said Eeyore in a glum-sounding voice. "We just thought we'd check to see if you're okay," said Piglet, "because we hadn't heard from you, so we wanted to know if you were doing all right."
"Am I okay?" he asked. "To be honest, I feel rather sad and alone and not much fun to be around at all, which is why I haven't bothered you, because you wouldn't want to waste your time hanging out with someone who is sad and alone and not much fun to be around at all, now would you?"
"We're sitting here with you," said Pooh, "because we're your friends, and true friends don't care if someone is feeling sad or alone or not much fun at all to be around. True friends are there for you anyway, and so are we."
"Oh," said Eeyore.
And while Pooh and Piglet said nothing at all, somehow, almost imperceptibly, Eeyore started to feel a tiny bit better, because Pooh and Piglet were there, no more, no less.
This is a song called House at Pooh Corner. And how many have heard this song before? Oh, hardly none of you. I just found out before coming up here that Robin Patterson and her brother was named Christopher from Christopher Robin the Story. I never knew that. So, and she's never heard the song before. Neither have I, for that matter. But anyway, here's how it goes. Thank you.
Lots of good music today. Now it's time for our candles of joy and sorrow. It's time to take a moment to reflect on our joys and sorrows and acknowledge the mutual support of our community. If you would like, you may come forward and light a candle in silence or with a brief verbal expression of a special joy or sorrow.
Father Candle, for all the churches this morning who are joyfully celebrating the eclipse, I've heard of multiple churches who are offering up rooms to strangers and having other big celebrations today. So it sounds so special, and I'm happy for them. And lastly, we're going to light one more candle for all the joys and sorrows that remain in our hearts but unspoken. I invite you to join me in the spirit of prayer, and we can do this by maybe getting comfortable a second. I invite you to move around in your chairs and settle in. You might put your feet on the ground if you need to feel grounded, or in whatever other way feels comfortable. There's no right way to this. You can close your eyes if that feels good, or lower your gaze a little bit, relaxing. And we'll take a couple deep breaths together, only if that feels good. So we'll take a deep breath in and out. And a deep breath in and out. And one more. Deep breath in. And out. Spirit of life and love, Goddess, God, Spirit of many names and of no names at all, presence in the universe, the atoms that vibrate under our skin, in our skin. We come together praying for many things, for those who are experiencing illness in our lives, new diagnoses, coughs, everything that makes life a little bit harder today, all that pain and suffering. We pray for that. We also pray for those in our midst who are feeling grief, for those who are mourning, ones who are lost long ago, and for those who are mourning recent losses, husbands, great aunts, others who have been lost today. We also pray for those who are feeling scared or hungry, who are suffering in an unjust world from war and bombings and heartbreak. We send our love and our healing energy from us to those who need it. Spirit, we also pray for those experiencing joy, for those who love science and love the moving of the sky and the moon and the sun, for those who are celebrating birthdays, big and small, anniversaries, for those who are just feeling good today. We hope your joy increases. We send you our excitement and joy and love, helping you feel it even deeper, and sharing it with the world as much as you can. pray for all of this. Let us take a moment of silence. Amen.
We were glad to invite one of the most beloved congregants, long-term congregants, to give the stewardship testimonial today, but they couldn't make it, so I'm going to do it. Here I am, an unchurched SBNR, a nun, an atheist. Why in the world would anyone ask me for a testimonial? Well, I've been coming here for over 15 years, almost every Sunday, most Wednesdays, and often when something breaks. I first came to PUC, hiding in the shadow of my wife, hoping no one I knew would see me. I figured that if I came a couple of times, her curiosity would wane and we could stop coming. Well, what I experienced when I got here was that calorie-free Snicker bar I spoke of before, a grand place touting a grand message of acceptance and peace and no expectation of genuflection or forced belief in some dogmatic practice that made me no sense at all to me. It took two Reverend Morehouse sermons to hook me in. It took a welcoming congregation of folks who took us in and let us help. It took a few sunny days overlooking the canyon, eating the lunch, helping the homeless with their laundry, and a lot of work on understanding my own ideology and beliefs. Turns out, community is a necessary thing in one's life. I'm glad to have one here. I need to do what I can to help make it thrive. So, if you relate to any of this and you want to see PUC continue to work its magic on people, do as I do, pledge and give. We don't need your money today, just your honest promise to give it over the next 12 months. But if you pledge today, it will help us plan for those next 12 months. And you might just learn a thing or two about yourself. Time for centering hymn number 326, Let All the Beauty We Have Known.
Rejoice in wonders daily shown. faith and joy and love that binds. We celebrate with singing hearts the loveliness of sky and earth, the inspiration of the arts, the miracle of every birth. Life's music and its poetry surrounds and blesses us through our days. For these we sing, and in harmony together giving thanks and praise.
Our reading today is called In Art Class, Making Aspen Trees, and it's by Rosemary Watola Trommer. Everything is flexible, said Kelly as she sprayed her painting with water and then held the canvas on its side until the white paint streaked across her forest. And for 6 hours, I lived in that fixable world of paint and paper and brushes and stencils, a world of improvisation and play, a world where I wandered in pale green and deep blue, where I trusted a glade of my own making, rested in that shade, where there were no problems, just new invitations to reimagine what might happen next. And smudges became birds, and tears became trees, and my sorrow became an aspen grove where nothing was fixed, but for 6 sacred hours, there was nothing the light couldn't touch. I first learned how to knit when I was 9 or 10 years old. My mother is a knitter. She knits socks and beautiful shawls. She taught me to knit, and my grandmother, my dad's mother, taught her how to knit. I imagine a long line of generation after generation in the Netherlands having passed on this tradition through the family. When I visited my parents again last month, I found myself sitting in a farmhouse in rural Virginia on a Monday afternoon. My mom had invited me along to a friend's house for their knitting group. I started a small project, a green and white dishcloth with cotton yarn. I'm gonna cause some banging, apparently. Cotton yarn is not stretchy and flexible like wool, but it can be washed repeatedly. So you can see it here. And this is the dishcloth that I have started to make. I took the same project with me to a minister's retreat a couple weeks ago, joining 6 or 7 other ministers who knitted or crocheted as we learned about trauma. I like knitting because it takes something simple, yarn, and creates something new. It's almost as if you're creating something complex out of the simplest of tools. Like you're creating something out of nothing, almost. A spiritual practice is an activity you do that connects you to something greater than yourself. Some might call it God. Others might say it's a way of feeling more connected to the universe or to themselves, or even being grounded in the moment, a kind of meditation. I deeply believe that art and creativity are kinds of spiritual practice. After I graduated from college, I spent 4 months working on an alpaca farm in Virginia. I would take a ferry over the river from Williamsburg, Virginia, to more rural Surrey, and spend the day sorting alpaca fleece for spinning into wool. I learned that alpacas have not been domesticated as long as sheep and goats, and aren't the friendliest of animals. My job did not involve cuddling with any alpacas or llamas, much to my dismay. I did, though, learn the feel of wool because between my fingers, I learned how it felt and came to know the difference between types of alpaca hair, types of wool, and other fibers. For the less than minimum wage that job paid, it made me love knitting that much more. Even the act of carding my hands through an alpaca fleece and removing leaves and sticks and dirt felt like a meditation or spiritual practice. I felt connected to the earth and to nature, grounded in the moment as I cleaned and sorted wool. Questlove, the drummer and frontman of the band The Roots, has spent a lot of time thinking about creativity and art. He doesn't like the standard definition that deems something creative if it's original. Instead, he keeps it simple and says it's just the act of creating something, original or not original. We're going to need a definition of a creative person to go forward, he says. Here's a first stab at it. A creative person is a person who creates. Let's start there. That's one of the fundamental lessons of creativity, he says. Don't be worried if an idea or a scene or a song comes to you in its most simplistic of forms. The partial arrival is a form of gestation. The seed is expert at turning into something else. A creative person is a person who creates. I like this idea. Rather than only calling someone an artist or creative if they're making something original, it's really about that act of creation. In a way, creating something out of something that's sometimes the simplest of ingredients. Making something different or even more complex. Questlove also says that people are differently creative. Some are creative in art, some in music, some in words, some in handicrafts. I can list many other things that we do that are creative. In a way, he both accepts the idea that everyone is creative and he qualifies it. Yes, everyone is creative, but not everyone is creative in the same way. This feels true for me. I'm a good knitter and a decent singer, but I will never be a famous painter or even an okay poet. Never be an okay poet. Though sometimes I do enjoy putting paint on a brush and just painting. We are all creative in our own ways. Creativity can also be a gift and a relief in hard times. It can remind us that there is beauty to be found around us, even in the midst of terrible times. During the pandemic, I was having trouble concentrating. Everything I needed to do and everything I used to do for fun was unappealing or stressful. The grief of everything was getting me down. One night, I sat in bed and asked myself, what do I have the capacity for right now? Reading felt overwhelming. Social media was likely going to make it feel worse. My project during the pandemic, sending my friends and loved ones postcards, also felt like too big of a task. And on top of everything, I was just too awake to sleep. So I asked myself again, what do I need right now? What do I have the bandwidth for? I decided I had the energy to just look. To just look at something beautiful. I didn't have the energy to create myself. Instead, I just observed and appreciated and allowed myself to be distracted. I downloaded an art book by the painter William Woodward. Woodward grew up in Seekonk, Massachusetts, near Providence, Rhode Island, and after studying at the Rhode Island School of Design and Mass Art, he moved to New Orleans to teach at Tulane. On his honeymoon, he witnessed the Impressionist styles in Paris and soon adopted it to his work, mixing Impressionist techniques with a passion for architectural preservation. And Kelly's going to show a couple of his paintings now, I think. Woodward is known for painting beautiful scenes from the streets and architecture of New Orleans and the surrounding natural environment. Woodward retired to Biloxi, Mississippi in 1923. 2 years before, he had been painting a mural and fell. He injured his spine and was confined to a wheelchair for the rest of his life. He painted through his retirement, using a specially equipped automobile to drive around the United States and continue his work. His paintings swept me away in that moment. One painting in particular, and it's actually this one, so we'll stay on it for a second. One painting in particular had me able to imagine myself walking down a dirt road with fields and grass around me. The road along the river I could see on the side, and as I walked, I could feel the sun and the breeze and even smell the grass. I experienced the peace of a lazy day out in nature through the painting. I was carried away to Woodward's Biloxi. This distraction, this beautiful distraction, had brought me to a new place. I needed to be reminded that there was still beauty in the world, even in the midst of the pandemic. When times are hard, distractions can be helpful. Art and creativity can take us to new places, even if it's just for a moment. It can remind us of the beautiful world that exists, even when beauty feels hard to grasp. In the case of that painting, I could be far away on a dirt road in Mississippi, enjoying the sunshine instead of the harsh cold and the feeling of being stuck inside during the early days of the pandemic in Boston. Creativity can be a gift to the world. Others' creativity can transport us to new places. It can help us connect to the spirit or the beauty in the world. How do you let creativity, your creative side, shine through? Is it in coloring books or handcrafts? Do you write or sing, or perhaps appreciate the art of others? How are you creative? I said earlier that art and creativity can be a part of spiritual practice. And I'm going to invite you all to do one with me today. It's called Praying in Color. The author of this practice, Sybil Macbeth, says, "Praying in color is an active, meditative, playful prayer practice. It is both process and product. The process involves a re-entry into the childlike world of coloring and improvisation. The product is a colorful design or drawing that is a visual reminder of the time spent in prayer." She invites us to do this, and you have a sheet of paper in your order of service, and you might have gotten a crayon or colored pencil as you came in. And if you didn't, or you're missing one, you can just raise your hand a little bit, and I think John will bring one to you. So I'm going to give you the instructions now, and then we're going to take a couple minutes for you just to have your prayerful coloring time. This is what Macbeth says. Draw a shape on the paper, a triangle or a trapezoid, squiggly line or imperfect circle. Write the name of the person for whom you want to pray or think about in or near the shape. Take some time to add detail to the drawing. This might be dots or lines or circles or zigzags or whatever your hand wants to do. Continue to enhance the drawing. Think of each stroke and each movement as the time that you spend with the person in prayer, the time that you spend thinking about them. Keep drawing until the image feels finished. Add color to the picture, perhaps trading with the person next to you. Choose colors that will stay in your memory, that you particularly like, or that remind you of the person for whom you are thinking about. So we're gonna take a couple of minutes and have time for you to write that person down and to let your hand do what it wants as you think about them. So take about 30 more seconds and finish up. Thank you, everyone. So this is yours to keep. You can do whatever you'd like with it. I was reflecting on a friend of mine who's been struggling with chronic illness, and so I might just send her a picture of it that I was artfully praying for her. We can all be creative in our own ways. I hope you all will take whatever creativity you have, whether it's small or large, little things or big things, and share it with the world. It's an important way of spreading beauty and reminding all of us that we're loved and held. Thank you. May it be so. Amen.
Well, we've come to Alex's favorite part of the service. That's the offertory. I have for you today another untrue story that never happened. In a mythical town just north of here, there was a very nice old historic building that was shared by three churches: a Catholic church, a Jewish synagogue, and a Unitarian fellowship. All three denominations were very happy having such a nice facility and shared the space in a kind and equitable manner. All was going well until one evening a small fire broke out in the back of the building near the offices. The priest, the rabbi, and the UU minister were called to the scene. When they arrived, they discovered that no one was in the building, so no lives were at stake. Upon hearing that no lives were in danger, the priest bravely dashed into the church, gathered up the sacred materials of the Holy Communion, and carried them out of the church, thus saving them from damage. This prompted the rabbi to run into the synagogue area and collect the sacred scrolls before they could be ruined. He returned with the sacred scrolls and thanked God for his good fortune. It was at this time the office administrator of the UU church ran up to the Unitarian minister, yelling that the fire department were on their way. "But don't worry," she said, "I've already removed the photocopier and the coffee machine. Please help us keep the coffee coming by giving generously."
It is time now that we thrive. It is time we live. turning we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love. We shall be known by the company we keep, by the ones who circle around to tend these fires. We shall be known by the ones who sow and reap the seeds of change, a life from deep within the earth. It is time now. It is time now that we thrive. It is time we lead ourselves into the well. It is time now. And what a time to be alive. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love. We shall be known by the company we keep, by the ones who circle round to tend these fires. We shall be known by the ones who sow and reap the seeds of change, alive from deep within the earth. It is time now. It is time now that we thrive. It is time we lead ourselves into the well. It is time now. And what a time to be alive. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love.
Yeah. Great job, choir. Now it's time for our closing hymn, number 1024, When the Spirit Says Do. I think we're rising up for this one if you'd like to.
You gotta do when the Spirit says do. You gotta do when the Spirit says do. When the Spirit gotta do, oh Lord, you gotta do when the Spirit says do. Spirit says do, 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 Spirit says do. You gotta do when the Spirit says do. You gotta drink when the Spirit says it. You gotta dance when the Spirit says dance. When the Spirit says dance, you gotta dance, oh Lord. You gotta dance when the Spirit says dance. Yeah, Spirit says dance, 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 Spirit says dance. You gotta laugh when the Spirit says laugh. Gotta laugh when the Spirit says laugh. You got to laugh along. You got to laugh when the spirit says laugh. Oh, spirit says laugh. 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 You got to do when the spirit says shout. You gotta shout when the spirit says shout. When the spirit says shout, you gotta sing along. You gotta shout when the spirit says shout. And spirit says shout. 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 You gotta do when the spirit says do. You gotta do. You gotta do, oh Lord. You gotta do when the spirit says do. Spirit says do.
Grab onto someone close to you if you'd like, or you can even give yourself a hug or stay seated. It's up to you. This church is dedicated to the proposition that behind all our differences, beneath all our diversity, there is a unity that makes us one and binds us forever together. In spite of time and death and the space between the stars, we pause in silent witness to that unity.
May the blessing of love be upon you. May love's peace abide with you. May love's presence illuminate your hearts, now and forevermore. So be it. Amen. Shalom, salam, namaste, and blessed be. And now the service truly begins.
Woo! Let's welcome Shayna Hammer.
Yay, Shayna. So we have a postlude from Shayna. Softly now, with the dawn, I will ride with the wind, o'er the hills, through the mist, on the wings of thee. Spirit fly, to the cloud up above. Spirit fly to a place beyond the sky. Spirit